So the speaker of today is Takahiro Terada from IBS. He will talk about minimal supergravity inflation and non-slow gravitino. Please.
Thank you for introduction and thank you for invitation to this seminar. And I'm sorry for this technical problems. So this title is somewhat ambiguous, maybe you noticed, and let me explain. So this is basically about inflation in supergravity setup. And this means that we have minimal degrees of freedom for inflation in supergravity. Namely, there is only single inflaton and massive gravitino and massless graviton. That's all. And previously in the literature, it was known that there is some kind of problem or some issue, either theoretical or phenomenological, which I will explain in this talk. And in that case, the problem is related to the existence of slow gravitino. The meaning of slow is that its propagation speed, limiting propagation speed, is less than the speed of light. And so too many slow gravitinos are produced in that situation. And in the first part of the talk, I will explain this problem. And in the second part, I will introduce alternative, this kind of models without the slow gravitino. So today I will talk about two kinds of topics, respectively. These papers are the reference. Can be a dark matter candidate if the R parity is unbroken. And in this talk, maybe the most relevant part is this one. So this is related to the tame down of the cancellation of radiative corrections between bosons and fermions. The CMB data indicates that the inflaton potential may be very flat. And this will be related to the cancellation of radiative corrections. Otherwise, the inflaton potential becomes too steep. And if you are somewhat familiar with supergravity, you know that this is not enough. But anyway, this can be a zero or first step to constructing successful inflationary models. Also, there are other reasons to consider supersymmetry. Or if we consider the local supersymmetry, it becomes supergravity. Okay, but supersymmetry must be broken in reality because we do not see supersymmetric particles at the LHC. Of course, this is also true for any kinds of new physics models, but anyway, this is a kind of phenomenological observation, but even theoretically, supersymmetry must be broken in the cosmological background. What I mean is that in cosmology, there is always a Hubble expansion. And whenever there is a positive energy contribution in the universe, then it breaks supersymmetry. So written here is a usual setup. Usually in supersymmetry phenomenology, we assume this kind of usually static order parameter of the supersymmetry breaking. It is called F term auxiliary value and D term auxiliary field value. And in more general, we have kinetic term of say scalar fields. Furthermore, generally we have this kind of Hubble expansion and or finite temperature in the universe, and this necessarily breaks supersymmetry. So Supersymmetry breaking is kind of ubiquitous phenomena if we consider cosmology. Once supersymmetry is broken, sometimes this, the screen, I experienced this in Pascos and I heard that how to solve this situation, but it doesn't fix. So let me again use a PDF file. Sorry. I will share. Sorry. So do you see the mouse pointer?
Yes.
Thank you. So, okay, so now supersymmetry breaking is ubiquitous in cosmology. And once supersymmetry is broken, generic fields receive a mass of order the Hubble parameter. This is also called Hubble-induced mass. So this means that, for example, if there is a curve trajectory in the field space, then sometimes orthogonal modes transverse to the inflaton trajectory, local minimum trajectory is excited. And that kind of signal can be potentially observed. Ah, by the way, Shuntaro is working on this one, right? Cosmological collider. This kind of thing is interesting and recently actively studied in under the name of cosmological collider. This is not the main topic of this talk, but so this is a kind of generic expectation and it's interesting. But today I want to focus on different situation where fields becomes much heavier than the Hubble scale. And why this happens? This can happen in some model building setup. Let me explain. So for example, if you try to build an inflation model, there are some constraints. For example, isocurvature constraints. These are observational constraints. Isocurvature perturbation means that basically, roughly speaking, the fluctuation different in the fluctuations in other fields than the inflaton. So basically, we want to make other fields heavy, so that it is stabilized at some value and do not fluctuate during the inflation. So for this kind of strong stabilization, we introduce this kind of higher order term in the Kähler potential. And after this field, for example, if this X field obtains an F term vacuum expectation value, this becomes an effective mass term of the field X. So, also, this is used in moduli stabilization context. Humir also wrote a paper in the context of Higgs inflation. So after the decoupling, so now this field becomes receives mass, large mass, and they decouple from inflationary dynamics. After the decoupling, the original superfield now contains an partial component, only partial ingredients in the supermultiplet. So it forms an incomplete supersymmetry multiplet. And naively, it's difficult to describe such kind of Suzy broken fields, but it's possible to describe it in terms of constrained superfields. Famous, relatively well-known example of constrained superfield is a so-called nilpotent superfield. So let's call it X. This is sometimes denoted as S in the literature, but here let's call it X. And then it satisfies X squared equals zero. So this is the meaning of nilpotent. So without nilpotency condition, we can expand a chiral superfield X like this. Here X, small X is the scalar component, and its super partner is this chi X. This is a fermion spinner, and there is an auxiliary field Fx. And they are related by supersymmetry. And this theta is the Grassmann coordinate. It's a superspace coordinate. This is also fermionic. Now, we have this nilpotency condition. So by imposing this, we can solve this relation. And the consistency with this condition constraint gives us this relation. Namely, the bosonic component X can be replaced in terms of the fermion bilinear. So effectively, this constraint kills this component. Okay, so I draw some idea about. So initially there are some light fields, but after the decoupling of this field, some components become heavy. And if this is heavier than the Hubble scale, then they decouple. And the two useful tool to describe the remaining degrees of freedom are the constraint superfields. And this is now the supersymmetry is non-linearly realized. So this is the basic story about nonlinear supersymmetry and constraint superfields. And this is relatively well understood for the bosonic cases or scalar fields. And today's topic is related to how about decoupling of fermions. And in the case of fermions, the construction of UV theory will become non-trivial. Recently, I read some papers, but there are several several models, but the relation among them are not so clear to me. But anyway, let's consider the phenomenological implications of what happens if we decouple fermions and to describe the remaining degrees of freedom in terms of constraint superfield. And also this, before going to details, because this is related to the gravitino story, so let me briefly introduce the cosmological gravitino problem. And some of you may be already familiar and some of you maybe not. So in general, not restricted to gravitino. In general, unstable long-lived particles can be problematic depending on its mass and decay rate and also abundance. This is because, for example, decay products can affect the light element abundance produced by the Big Bang nucleosynthesis. Also, if the long-lived particles, its lifetime is infinite, then it can be stable particles, or in that case, it can become dark matter, but if it is too abundant, then it can overproduce dark matter. Of course, the good point of the supersymmetry is there is a dark matter candidate, but this would become a problem. And other possibilities that this unstable long particles decay and the decay products of the unstable particles also become dark matter candidate. And so even if the heavy particles decay much before the Big Bang nucleosynthesis, the decay particles abundance should be also small. Okay, so the production channels of gravitinos can be not unique, and there may be various production. Broadly speaking, we can divide into two classes. One is thermal production, namely the scattering process in the thermal bath. Typically, in the case of minimal supersymmetric standard model, gravitino is produced from, for example, gluon and gluonino scattering. And another channel is non-thermal production. This is, for example, from decay of some heavier scalars such as inflaton or moduli. So in our context, we focus on inflaton decay or so this can be a perturbative decay or more non-perturbative thing like preheating. And here, this is an example from this reference. This is about the BBN constraint to show how the BBN constraints are severe. And note that the precise constraint can depend on the parameters of the theory. For example, this is a supersymmetric theory, so this is just a single benchmark point presented in their paper more than 10 years ago. So if we choose some supersymmetry parameter still not excluded by LHC, these constraints may be modified somehow. But anyway, there is some known constraints on the reheating temperature, which is related to this thermal production. So this paper basically here assumes that the gravitino is produced by the thermal production. And the constraint is written on the reheating temperature. But we can translate this constraint upper bound on the reheating temperature to the abundance of the gravitino mass. Okay, so this is the introduction.
So I have a question. So for the gravitino abundance, can you lower to smaller gravitino masses here?
Yeah.
There's some vertical, orangey line. I don't know what is the orangey line, but you stopped at 100 GeV, right? Can you go to lower gravitino masses?
Yeah, in that case, we can circumvent BBN bound, and basically we need to consider dark matter abundance. Also, there may be some constraints related to warm dark matter. Mm. If the dark matter becomes very light, then it becomes warm. So one should be careful about that kind of constraints. Mm. I think maybe KeV, I don't remember the exact constraints. But yeah, right. So there is some other constraints.
So I see there's some dotted line in this figure. So which is the abundance from the thermal production?
This dotted line, this line is the dark matter abundance. So if the reheating temperature is higher than this line, 10 to 11 GeV, then gravitino decays into lightest supersymmetric particle, and that abundance
LSP. Exceeds. I see.
Yeah, LSP abundance exceeds the dark matter.
Yes. Okay.
But this is just a,
some
rough picture in 28, 13 years ago.
Some time ago.
13 years.
Yeah, I see. Okay.
So, yeah. Just to show the rough picture. Are there any other questions? Maybe for students, it's better to ask basic questions at the introduction. Okay. If not, I maybe need to speed up a little bit. Part one is about minimal supergravity inflation and some anomalous graviton production phenomena. Here, anomalous, by anomalous, I mean not the technical word, not the quantum anomaly, but in the usual sense, something unusual, strange, anomalous, or some surprising thing happens. So let's see. So the context is that this one, the decoupling and nonlinear CCP. And what happens when we decouple fermions? Okay. So this kind of situation was studied by these people. And the theory utilizes a special kind of constraint superfields. These constraint superfields, X and T, are called orthogonal nilpotent superfields. By the way, this is not the same notation in this paper, but this is notation in another paper. And this, usually inflaton is denoted by, for example, phi, but to distinguish it from the theory in the second part, I changed the notation to this kind. Anyway, notation is not so important, but the defining property of the orthogonal nilpotent superfields is this constraint. The x squared equals zero is the same as the nilpotency condition, which we saw here. So, and the another part is this orthogonality condition. So the constraint effectively kills these components. More precisely, these components can be written in terms of these other components. So in this way, the only independent degrees of freedom are these chi x and fx, and a single real component in T, the scalar part. However, F term is an auxiliary field. So independent and dynamical degrees of freedom are only this so-called stabilizino, chi x, and the inflaton here. Originally, this is a complex scalar field, but now it's a real scalar field because of the constraint. Now, in gauge theory, if gauge symmetry is spontaneously broken, it is eaten. The Goldstone boson is eaten by the longitudinal mode of the gauge field, and it becomes longitudinal mode of the gauge boson. And the same thing, this is called this mechanism, and the same thing happens in supersymmetry. In this case, fx is supposed to be non-zero, and this is the supersymmetry breaking multiplet, basically. So this corresponds to chi x, corresponds to the Goldstone. Then this is eaten by gravitino, which is the gauge field of supersymmetry. So the gravitino becomes massive by the super Higgs mechanism, and it obtains a longitudinal mode, which is originally this one, the stabilizino in this model. So finally, the physical spectrum is very simple. There is only a real single degree of freedom, the inflaton, also gravitin and graviton. So this is very minimal in the supersymmetric context. And nevertheless, we can still describe the model using these constrained superfields. The advantage, advantage is that the simplicity, for example, many fields can be decoupled, and so the resultant model is very simple. Okay, so the model is specified by the scalar potential and superpotential. So using these ingredients, we can write down the scalar potential and superpotential. And if we consider the gauge theory, we need to put some other gauge kinetic function, for example. And from these kind of supersymmetry defining function, then we can derive this kind of scalar potential. Originally, there is exponential k factor here, for example, but now we use the fact that, for example, x equals zero, so it vanishes. And also, the imaginary part vanishes, so that kind of factor is trivially disappear. However, there is an unusual thing here, namely, there is this scalar potential is different from the standard one. Standard one, such as what written in supergravity textbook. This was emphasized in these papers, and this is because this constraint already effectively kills this F term, inflaton F term, at the off-shell level. So this is very strange from the standard point of view. Because of this, the scalar potential is different from the standard one. For example, in the standard case, there is a derivative of this term, but it's absent in this framework.
So in this construction, the constraint equation is included as the Lagrangian multiplier somewhere in the how to implement them. With the Keller and the spot potential, you can compute the potential, right?
Yes. We can compute the scalar potential, and before scalar potential at the off-shell level, and then impose this constraint.
So you impose a constraint and just set the inflaton F term to zero, and the fermions, just you are eliminating those fields, like small x and the inflatino.
Yeah, so most generally, these red slashed one is replaced by something like bilinear or more complicated expression in terms of this chi x, something like this, or more mm-hmm. complicated version of this.
Mm-hmm.
But if we impose unitarity gauge, then it becomes simply zero. So,
mm-hmm.
so in this sense, it's enough to substitute zero after calculating the standard expression. But yes. one should, so in this theory, this is a little bit special. So one need to first write down F T, the inflaton F term, and do not replace it by as in the usual the superpotential derivative term. But on the other hand, you need to set it zero or some fermionic expression.
So then somehow these additional conditions kind of you have some heavy field. Somehow you do have in mind that some another field that stabilizes or imposes those conditions, because just from the Lagrangian or I mean the spot potential and the Keller potential, there is no reason for them to be imposed, right?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. Maybe I can show some references later. For example, Karosh et al. Proposed two kinds of UV completion. I mean, I'm not sure it's completed really, but UV models to produce this constraint. We can discuss it later.
Okay, let me see.
So already at this point, this theory has some special feature, but more dramatic thing happens for the fermionic sector, in particular for the gravitino, because the longitudinal gravitino is tightly related to supersymmetry breaking. Similarly to the case of the gauge field, gauge longitudinal mode is basically Goldstone, corresponding to Goldstone mode. Okay, so now the longitudinal gravitino Lagrangian up to the quadratic order is written like this. And here, this is a special feature that the limiting propagation speed of the gravitino mode, the longitudinal mode, is different from one or C, the speed of light. And this is called the so-called sound speed parameter. Maybe the terminology of sound may be not so good for fermionic field, but anyway. This so-called sound speed parameter changes. Fortunately, this does not exceed one. The absolute value does not exceed one. So there is no superluminal propagation. So that's okay. But something still strange happens. I mean, so let's see. This parameter is written in terms of the kind of universal properties like pressure and energy density of the cosmic fluid. We can derive this kind of formula after not very short calculation in supergravity. So for example, this notation has a physical meaning. PSB is the pressure of the cosmic fluid responsible for the supersymmetry breaking. And rho SB is the similarly the Suzy breaking contribution to the energy density. And I don't have a good interpretation of PW, but it is a time derivative of the gravitino mass, or the, basically the time derivative of the superpotential. Maybe it's better to say the gravitino mass time derivative. So this is proportional to gamma naught. This is a Dirac matrix, one of the Dirac matrix. Okay, so this is initially a matrix, but for the purpose of explanation, let's first neglect this part. This is possible if this is small. And then this becomes a real number. And also, since these are written in terms of energy density and pressure, we could discuss it in terms of only the equation of state or some very generic argument. But to see, to obtain some intuition, let's imagine this kind of inflaton potential. And let's imagine that after inflation, inflaton rolls down like this. And so I match the notation to the previous line. So this is inflaton. T is inflaton here. Vt is the inflaton potential. Now, by this assumption, this is a real number. And initially, this is negative. Here, this negative sound speed parameter does not mean negative sound speed. This is because this is just a parameter in the Lagrangian. And you can understand this. For example, mass term of fermion is, its sign is not physical. We can rotate the field phase. And so, you know, the equation of motion of fermion is this kind of fast derivative thing. And to obtain the Klein-Gordon-like equation, we combine two equations, two fast order equations to obtain the usual propagation equation. So in that process, we the information of sign is disappears. Similarly, the sign of this sound speed parameter is irrelevant naively. But the sign change, this sign change has a physical meaning potentially. So and we can actually solve the equation of motion of this system after expanding the field as in the conventional way. We can expand it in terms of annihilation operator and creation operator and its coefficients. And we can solve the equations for the coefficient modes. So, and then we obtain the phase space number density of each mode. And surprisingly, this, this occupation number of each mode grows very sharply, like step function from 0 to 1. You can first forget about the latter part, but initially it rises from 0 to 1. And this is independent of momentum, K. So this implies that any mode, each mode of the gravitino produced, and the particle number becomes 0 to 1. And one is maximum for fermion because of Pauli blocking. So this is very strange. You know, this is independent of K. So if we, if, yeah, this, this is the point. If we neglect back reaction and suppose the coherent oscillation of inflaton, this would imply infinite modes are produced up to some cutoff scale, whatever the cutoff scale is, as far as the back reaction is small. So it implies necessary back reaction becomes important and the precise calculation is so difficult. Actually, after we wrote the paper, we also tried to correctly incorporate the back reaction, but it's so, this system is so strange that in some sector, negative energy appears and it compensates with positive, large positive energy. It's so confusing, and I don't know how to calculate that. But anyway, so it implies that a huge number of the gravitino would be produced by this. So this is just an order of magnitude estimate, but number density of the gravitino can be at least naively calculated like estimated like this. If there is some UV cutoff scale lambda, then it can be proportional to lambda cubic. And if we compute the energy density, it becomes lambda quartic. So if we take it for granted for this validity of the effective theory, then it will certainly lead to the phenomenological catastrophe. So somehow Kolb et al. Also revisited this problem very recently, and they call this catastrophic graviton production. And however, this might be just a breakdown of the effective theory, and this point is not so trivial, but yeah, this is also a possibility. Breakdown of the effective theory, and then we should not believe this result. In fact, I don't have to go to the last slide. Maybe I should say some point. Because the solution of this orthogonal nilpotency condition is written in terms of this. So previously I said that in unitary gauge, these become zero and many things become zero, but the general expression is like this. So if fx becomes zero, fx is the f term of the stabilizer field or the nilpotent field, many expression become singular. So in this sense, we do not expect that the effective theory is valid at this point, origin. At the origin, F term vanishes. So it is suspicious that the effective theory is still valid on this at the origin because F is vanishes. Somehow, the gravitin Lagrangian does not become singular in this limit.
I don't.
Yes?
I cannot see your full screen. So it's too small to see. So.
Too small to see.
Sorry, can you make it to
go back to full screen? Now, do you see the full screen?
Right? Yeah, I can see. Yeah.
Okay, so at this, if this goes to this point, probably the effective theory breaks down and we need to linear version of the theory. But the problem, the putative problem happens before that. So it's still mysterious. Maybe I should skip some technical details. And if you have some questions, we can discuss it later. So the point is that it's not trivial whether this is real phenomenon or breakdown of the theory. First possibility
Can you go back to the sound speed?
Yes.
So you have two contributions to the sound speed. So yes. Here, Suji breaking field contribution coming from the Suji breaking is the inflaton. Can I say inflaton potential? So Suji breaking, so you need the non-zero F term from the Suji breaking field, and this non-zero vacuum energy contribution from Suji breaking will be for inflation, right?
Right. So the inflaton potential is given by the F term of the so-called stabilizer superfield, yeah. Fx.
Mm-hmm. So that you denoted SP. It's SP is the Suji breaking field X, right? X in your previous slide.
Yes, and also there is another contribution from the kinetic energy of the inflaton. Mm-hmm. This is unimportant during the inflation, but at this stage, it becomes comparable to the potential energy.
I see. So here, okay. So Suji breaking field. I see. So energy density for the Suji breaking field. So I want to understand how do you get low plus something? Yeah. So there is the second term is the super potential square.
Right. Exactly.
Global Suji. I say so low SP is the global Suji potential.
Low SP, not exactly the global Suji potential, but
F term.
Yes, F term, right. Mm-hmm. F term. Exactly.
So
in this paper and in this talk, I do not consider D term, but if D term is present, D term should be also included here in within row.
Under
row. Because it also breaks supersymmetry and contributes to the energy density of the universe.
I see. So you, for instance, if you have a hybrid inflation, then you need to consider D term, F term, and D term at the same time, for instance.
Yes.
For current discussion, are you focusing on F term Suji breaking or?
Yeah.
It could be.
Ah, yes, I'm focusing on F term Suji breaking because it's simple and also D term is kind of irrelevant. I mean, we can, of course, we can generalize the discussion in that case, but it's not an essential part of the problem.
Mm-hmm.
So I omit the D term.
I see. So also the PW is the kind of a time-dependent gravitino mass term, right? Time-dependent.
Right. So it's a time derivative of the gravitino mass, and gravitino mass is in general time-dependent.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why this is m dot.
Okay. So I want to understand how to get the time derivative in front of the special derivative.
In front of the spatial derivative. Yes. Ah, good question. This Lagrangian is obtained after some manipulation. You know, so in the supergravity context, there is some gravitino field action first, and this is not decomposed into transverse mode and longitudinal mode, and it also has auxiliary component. And we need to be careful about how to decompose it. And in that process, decomposing process, we need to do some field redefinition or using equation of motion for gravity, like Friedman equation. And also, yeah, there is some covariant derivative of supergravity, which includes some factor like gamma 5 or here it's not gamma 5 appearing, but I don't have a short answer for why time derivative appears here, but this is this appears in combination with gamma 0, gamma nu partial mu, and so this is obtained after some manipulation, some calculation.
So this longitudinal, the way you identify the longitudinal gravitino is through the mixing between would be goldustino and gravitino, right? So I forgot, but the mixing between like in the gauge theory, you are identifying mixing between gauge boson and
right.
Would be called the Stone boson. So
mixing is important,
right? Yeah. So I think that is the in more detail. So please continue so we can also discuss. I wanted to actually I didn't try to derive this formula by myself, so I want to understand better the origin. So okay,
this is rather. This needs rather lengthy calculation.
It's kind of master, This is master formulas, right? Which is most important.
If we do that in the usual supergravity, this can be one. But, or I'd say. Yeah, I will have some related slide for this. Oh. This is a more detailed version of this is the equation version of what I said. This is the equation of motion for this mode. And under some limit or approximation, we obtain this analytic solution for the mode. But this approximation is a little bit subtle because this requires the gravity mass goes to zero. And of course, we should not literally take this limit because otherwise it restores supersymmetry. It would restore a supersymmetry. But we want to consider supersymmetry breaking effective theory. So this maybe one should be more careful about that. But we can restore the gravitino mass, still much smaller than the Hubble. And we can argue that at least the order's magnitude estimate will not be affected by the inclusion of the gravitino mass. Basically, this affects long time scale phenomena, and also this sharp edge will be modified, smeared a little bit, but the main conclusion is not modified. And recently, actually, these people, Kolb et al. Did some numerical check about that. Okay. So this is also.
I think the Dirac equation is just first order, but in the process of making it second order, you have a time derivative of the mass term. And then is that the origin for the sound speed? I mean, the time dependent sound speed.
It's not time dependence is already
already included in the beginning.
Yeah.
I see. Okay. I see. You have an extra time dependence in the oscillator. Mode frequency.
So in this analysis, we assume that the inflaton can be treated as a background. And so as the inflaton evolves, time evolves, then the pressure and the energy density of the universe also depends on time. That's why this parameter also depends on time.
Okay, I still, so that is the extra, So that is the extra time dependence. Okay.
Yeah. And similarly, the Hubble in general depends on time and other quantities. So this effective mass term also depends on time.
Yeah.
And very strange thing is that this depends on the sign of the sound speed parameter. So if it changes sign, it quickly changes. So the point is that if the sign changes, then the positive frequency modes and negative frequency modes switch each other. So if we observe this, I myself naively think that, then maybe we should connect negative frequency modes to negative frequency modes in the next domain of solutions. I mean, what I'm saying is that at the moment of sign change, C vanishes. So the third term and first term vanishes. And so U prime must vanish. Right. And so at that moment, this does not, this is no longer second order equation. So there might be a priority, the possibility that maybe we should connect the positive frequency mode to positive frequency mode so that this production does not happen. However, this conservative standpoint does not hold. If we add very small regularization term, I assume that this function is constant. But if you remove this constraint, then that kind of argument does not hold, because in more general context, this sound speed parameter does not cross the origin on the complex plane, but it still have some non-zero absolute value. Maybe this explanation may be too technical, but anyway, the conclusion is that it seems that if you believe this effective theory, the production looks real. But it's not clear whether really this effective theory is valid, at least to me, so far. Since Hyunmin looks really interested in some details, I may not skip the details, but okay. Right, okay. So.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Yeah, actually, I wonder, you said the sounds cross the zero, that caused the problem. But I wonder how general this argument can be applied. Do you impose any assumption?
Yeah, on this slide, we assume that gravitino mass vanishes. In that case, we can derive it analytically. And so this corresponds to the sign change triggers this one. And to answer that question, it's better to switch, move to a different field basis. So this is an alternative interpretation of the analysis. We can redefine the field like this way, so that the speed of sound parameter cannot change sign. So this means that we can always rotate the field phase to compensate the phase of this parameter dynamically. And of course, if we do such kind of phase rotation with time-dependent phase, the time dependence is hit by this time derivative. So there is an effective mass term appearing here. By the way, I'm assuming a homogeneity of the background field, so there is only time derivative here. So in this field basis, since there is no change of sign, we can interpret the same thing as a change of the mass term. However, this change is spike-like. Usually in the standard or healthy or in many models of preheating, for example, this is more or less smooth. It maybe become, sometimes spike-like maybe, but sometimes vanishes. But in this case, it becomes a kind of delta function. So it's very strange again. And particle production is now understood as being caused by the non-adiabatic oscillating mass. So qualitatively, this is now looks similar to the standard preheating analysis, the standard phenomena observed in preheating analysis. But the point is that the adiabaticity is too extreme in this system. Does this answer your question? So for example, so previously I explained that let's neglect first gamma zero, and then this becomes a real number, so it can change the sign. But what happens if we do not neglect this gamma zero term? In that case, the sound speed parameter in each mode looks like complex number rather than gamma matrix, okay? Because we can look at each component. Then in a general situation, without neglecting this term, the complex sound speed parameter does not necessarily cross the origin of the complex plane. However, maybe here is the origin of the complex plane. I have not studied the concrete trajectory, but maybe something like this. It becomes close to the origin, but not touches that. But in that case, it may be not so easy to study it in the original frame, but we can easily understand in this frame. So in that kind of situation, the sound speed crossing does not happen. This is always positive, but we have still this effective mass change because of the time derivative. So as long as this kind of speed parameter change is quick, I mean, if this phase changes quickly, non-adiabatically, the particle production will happen.
Okay, but such a non-adiabaticity depends on the model.
Okay, so that the most important parameter is the ratio between the gravitino mass and the Hubble mass. So this happens for very small gravitino mass compared to the Hubble state. This is consistent with the conclusion by Kolpeter. They also claim that this happens for small gravitino mass. Now, of course, it's logically possible that in that regime already effective theory may be broken down. Yeah, but the point is that this happens only when gravitino mass is very small compared to the Hubble scale. This corresponds to the fact that this is small. So I said this kind of sound speed parameter in the complex plane, and this means that if the gravitino mass is comparable to the Hubble scale, this phase rotates regularly, because if everything is same order of magnitude, then this absolute value, this magnitude is always the similar thing. So I do not expect that the phase quickly changes. Phase quickly changes when it goes to close to the origin of the complex plane. Then phase quickly changes, as if we move on the real axis of the sound speed parameter.
So this PW term is important.
Yes.
So if you ignore the PW term, you have a problem with the sign change in the sound speed. you have a problem with the large production, I mean the large abundance. But if you have a non-zero PW, you said it corresponds to some complex sound speed. And you can avoid it.
Yes, if this is sufficiently large. But phenomenologically, there is still a problem because, so more general cases with G, this function to regularize the smallness of PW, then we can suppress this production by reducing the maximum production K. However, then you have standard decay channel from inflaton to gravitinos, this perturbative decay. So unfortunately, it's very difficult phenomenologically. This is the essence, I should say. So what is the essence of this strange phenomenon? In the standard case, without constraint, here constraints means constraints on superfields, constraint superfields, that kind of constraint. And fermion gradient terms can be diagonalized. So what is gradient term? Gradient term is this kind of term. So this is originally the gradient term, the nabla, the derivative, spatial derivative. So that it's a spatial gradient. So this is called a gradient term. And here, this is psi L is the longitudinal mode of the gravitino. And upsilon, or V, let's call it upsilon. Upsilon transverse perpendicular is the remaining fermionic modes. Why perpendicular? It's perpendicular to the Goldstone mode. Goldstone mode is already eaten by the Goldstone gravitino. So simply saying, these are the collection of every fermion in the theory. So it looks 2x2 matrix, but this epsilon perpendicular is long if you have many fields. So this sound speed matrix, so if we consider the total fields, set of every fields in your theory, then this is, in general, again, some kind of matrix. And I did not write an explicit formula for these terms, but anyway, it can be complicated. But the point is that even if this component, naively, this is the gravitino sound speed, even if this sound speed is not equal to one, usually the whole matrix satisfies this equation. If this is a standard system, then in that case, we can show that this sound speed matrix can be diagonalized into a unit matrix. So every eigenvalue becomes one. One means the speed of light. So there is no slow fermions in that case. So this is in the case of standard constraint, a standard case without constraints. What happens if we impose the constraints? If we impose the constraints, some fermions decouple and absent in the low energy effective theory. So we remove these rows and columns from the sound speed parameter matrix. And ultimately, we should reintroduce such kind of fields when these off-diagonal terms becomes important. So this is, in my opinion, this anomalous or catastrophic graviton production can be interpreted as the brute force intervention to this diagonalization process by the constraints, removing these fermions, relevant fermions by the constraints. So in more easier words, the lesson from this is that we should not remove the inflatino or other relevant fermions from the theory.
So this your kind of unitarity condition, where does it come from?
Unitarity condition.
So this capital C matrix 2x2, I mean, in general, arbitrary matrix.
This one?
Yeah, yes, whole matrix. The modulus of scale is called.
I should remember. First of all, this O is an orthogonal matrix that change field basis. So this is good. And alpha is the supersymmetry breaking fraction of each field, each superfield.
So it's kind of a unitarity. It's a unitarity condition.
Kind of. Underlying Lorentz symmetry. Unitarity. You talk like this. So maybe simply speaking, if we start from the standard case, then the fundamental theory has Lorentz symmetry, and we do not expect the breaking of that. I think I explicitly calculated this. But I don't remember the technical details of this general case. Maybe it's a combination of, maybe we can write explicit form of each component, then after some simple calculations, we have simply one. But sorry, I don't remember the details of how this appears. Basically, this depends on the Lorentz invariance of the underlying theory. Okay. So recently, some people, revisited the problem, and some said, conjecture something. Gravity and sound speed should not vanish. This is their claim. Some other people also proposed the Swampland conjectures related to Gravitino. So these, their point is that this is a first kind of Swampland conjecture applied to supergravity. So usually it's a Swampland is a constraint on quantum gravity, but they phrased like this is a Swampland on quantum supergravity. That is their claim. And in that context, other group also proposed such kind of Swampland conjecture related to Gravitino. But these constraints, these conjectures are more different from today's topic. And in this talk, I will not go into these conjectures. This is just a side remark. So the more recently, I wrote a paper about the alternative realization of minimal supergravity inflation without encountering such an anomalous gravitino production issue. So this is a, I would say simple, but somehow, maybe coincidentally, these people proposed this new constraint superfield. I don't know whether their work is motivated by Kolpetal. Kolpetal is February. It's February. They revisited the problem of the graviton production and proposed the conjecture. And seemingly unrelatedly, they proposed a constraint superfield, a new constraint superfield. It is not quite new because of this is already mentioned in the previous work as they write in their paper. But anyway, they study this system. Sorry for change of the notation, but this is the completely same as the their paper. Next, in the next slide, I will switch to the notation in my paper. But anyway, so this is chiral superfield expanded as usual. And this cubic nilpotent constraint, let's call it cubic nilpotent constraint because of a clear reason. This is cubic and nilpotent. So this S, the real part of the field, superfield, the bottom component of the superfield is replaced by chi and F and their derivatives like this. So here, sigma is the real part. Real part is constrained because it's cubic vanishes like this. So basically it's a combination of fermion like this. And here beta is very long expression in this written in the bottom of the slide. You don't need to try to remember the expression. This is just a long complicated expression for our purpose. But this is at the global supersymmetry level. So if you go to supergravity, it will be more complicated. So now we can relate this slide phi and the previous slide S, like S equals I phi or minus I phi, just a trivial phase rotation. So these are equivalent mathematically. So please don't be confused. It's not difficult, just a phase rotation.
What is the motivation for this another constraint? So instead of
what was their motivation?
So you are just another way of eliminating dynamical scalar field.
I guess so. My motivation is that somehow this paper appears and I thought that this can be used for realizing the so-called minimal supergravity inflation without encountering the graviton problem. I'm not sure their motivation. Maybe.
So this in this case, the real part of S is eliminated. And the other field kept Suji breaking and fermion.
For convenience of inflation model building, I kept the real part of the inflaton as dynamical. So by this change of basis, I eliminate imaginary part instead of real part. This is just convenient change of field basis. So basically equivalent. Okay, so I, for simplicity of calculation, I imposed the unitary gauge condition first, then it's really simplified and we can compute, we can obtain that the imaginary part in this case vanishes in the unitary gauge. So using this, we can easily calculate, for example, inflaton potential. It's almost 90 minutes, but so the point of this slide is that I want to say that inflation is possible in this alternative model, although the main message is that the gravitino problem, the catastrophic or anomalous gravitino problem related to the sun speed is absent. if inflation is not possible, it's useless. So that's why I include this slide. So this is just an expansion of generic Kera potential. And also super potential is at the conceptual level, this can be generic. Note that this is very trivial Taylor expansion. Here, it is expansion in terms of phi minus phi bar. This is zeroth order term, first order term, and second order term, and all higher order terms vanishes trivially because of the constraint. This, the real part is, in my convention, this is inflaton. So for the model building purpose, we impose shift symmetry in the Kera potential. This is conventional. So after imposing that, we can obtain this kind of scalar potential. This is a relatively general formula, but to proceed more, we need to specify the superpotential. And there may be various ways. Relatively developed recently, but anyway, already there are several ways. And this is one example. If we take this kind of superpotential, we obtain this kind of scalar potential. And so this is similar to the alpha attractor potential. So we can obtain inflation model, which is consistent with the Planck observation. The horizontal axis is the scalar spectral index, NS. And the vertical axis is the tensor to scalar ratio, R. Okay, so I will maybe skip this slide. This is just an detailed explanation of this model. This is based on the so-called alpha scale supergravity model in this paper, Diederik-Rust and Marcos Kalis. There is also another way by Sergey and myself. I also skip this unless there is a request, but so by using this, we can also construct Starobinsky-like or alpha attractor-like inflation potential with positive cosmological constant. And again, the potential looks similar to the previous slide. So we can also be consistent with the Planck data. Okay, so inflation is possible, by the way, with relatively simple superpotential and Kera potential. That's good. Now, the gravitino problem part is also simple. Because in our model, sound speed parameter satisfies this relation. That means that the gravitino is not slow. Its sound speed parameter, the sound speed is same as the sound speed of light. So there is no catastrophic anomalous production. In fact, we can calculate very simply, easily, like this.
I'm sorry. What is the difference between your previous model based on orthogonal?
Okay. So maybe it's not clear from this slide. So the essential difference is that, in their previous case, they start from two chiral superfields and impose some kind of constraint. And then, so originally there are two fermions and gravitino. And one fermion is removed by constraint. Mm-hmm. And the other one is absorbed into the gravitino by the superhex mechanism. We start from single chiral superfield. So there is a single fermion. And this is just absorbed by the super Higgs mechanism. By the super Higgs mechanism, it does not, it's, so the difference is that whether some fermion component is removed by the constraint. By the removal, this diagonalization process becomes affected. So that's why I said it's an essence of the anomalous production. So in the second case, in the second part of the model, we do not remove any fermion. It's only single superfield, and that's it. So there is no need for diagonalization.
In the second case, there is just one fermion, but which absorbed by the gravitino.
Yes, so only single component.
Okay. And then
one by one matrix.
In the first model, there is also one fermion, right?
Right. One fermion, but if we do not impose the constraint, there should be two. But it is removed by the constraint. So that's why without constraint, the whole matrix satisfies this relation, but this one component does not satisfy that.
Okay, so removed by constraint means it's somehow integrated out.
Yeah, that should correspond to that kind of thing. Expect that integrated fields cannot be neglected in the after the inflation.
Okay. Yeah, first of all, the spec contents of meta contents are a bit different from different two models.
Physical degrees of freedom are same, but the interactions and the Lagrangian are different. Physical components in both cases, real inflaton and massive gravitino and graviton. This is same. Physical contents are same, but the realizations are different.
Thanks.
So in this case, in this cubic nilpotent superfield, Suzy breaking comes from the inflaton multiply.
Suzy breaking comes right. So because there is, we start from single superfield. So which side is better? This one. So yeah, we only have this one, and we have Suzy breaking by the inflaton.
So in your concrete example, this F term for inflaton is non-zero.
Yes, non-zero.
I see.
Yes. So this is the main message of the talk, part two of the talk. But still, there is a standard graviton problem. I could skip this.
So the sound speed equal to one is it specific for your model, or is it? It can be more general.
Actually, this is a well-known result in the case of a single chiral superfield. If we start from a single chiral superfield, even if we impose constraint, as far as I know, this is satisfied. And so the earlier work did not consider the constraint superfields, but this is relatively already known in the previous works.
Yeah, for for constraint superfield, it looks to me that you are ignoring the imaginary part of the superfield and focusing on the real part of the superfield in the potential. And right, I mean the only difference is the maybe you are truncating higher order terms in the Keller potential by imposing constraint or by making certain assumption, right? Yeah. And then I see two effects. One is the high order corrections in the Keller potential, and another thing is the ignoring the imaginary part of the scalar field in the Lagrangian, right?
Yes.
And everything should be the same as in the case without constraint. Is that true? Or?
Yeah, as far as I'm aware, they are saying.
Hmm. Interesting. Yeah, it is interesting that we got the standard result. Don't be the problem. But okay, I see.
I forgot, yeah. Shuntaro asked some question in Pasco, so I thought that I should consider some example UV model of this cubic nilpotent one, but I forgot to come up with some UV example.
Do some people discuss the UV completion?
Maybe not yet.
Okay. So how about the orthogonal one?
Orthogonal nilpotent K is in our paper we mentioned that this kind of model could be understood as an UV model of the orthogonal nilpotent superfields with very specified superpotentials such that there is no anomalous production issue. But I didn't explain that, but yeah. If we tune the superpotential function in a very specific way, I mean, the PW term, if this is a satisfies a specific relation to other part of that model, then it satisfies the same form as the standard single field case. So I remember Antonio de Seta, yeah, these people discussed that we can combine orthogonal nilpotent superfields to obtain these degrees of freedom. This does not mean that the both theories are equivalent, because even we can combine and field by field redefinition, we can relate them. If we start from some definite Lagrangian for each theory, then the interactions can be different. Interaction terms in the Lagrangian are different. So this does not mean the equivalence of the theory themselves, but maybe we can also write this kind of single superfield standard models in terms of the constrained superfield as a low energy description.
So in that case, as you said, we don't have any catastrophic production of gravitino, because we have several fermion in the UV theory, and then removing some fermion degree of freedom leads to this kind of problem. I don't know.
If we start from the inflation models with single chiral superfield, then basically we can show that the sound speed parameter satisfies this relation.
Okay. And this hold for the single chiral multiplet case.
Yes.
Okay.
For multiple superfield case, we have to diagonalize the sound speed matrix.
Yeah. Let me discuss about this later. Yeah.
Ah, yes, thank you.
Yeah, it's a good idea to finish the talk and maybe have more discussion.
Wrap up.
So we can conclude.
So now, yes, the meaning of standard is that this is not related to the change of sound speed. So even if it is not related to the sound speed change, there is an interaction term in the supergravity Lagrangian. For example, inflaton can perturbatively decay into gravitinos. Through, for example, this mass term, by expanding this mass, take the derivative of this in with respect to the inflaton, there is interaction. So in this way, there is some other interaction terms, standard channels. So in that channels, we can see that, for example, if the gravitino is much less lighter than the inflaton, then the decay rate is large. And so this is a very, the remaining story is same as the conventional story. So maybe I should skip this. This is, I'm not going to the review the standard part today. This is same. So unfortunately, it can easily lead to a gravitino dominated universe. So abundant. Even this is not related to the sound speed change. This is because this is related to the fact that inflaton dominantly breaks supersymmetry. So there is no suppression. And there is actually enhancement factor if gravitino mass is light. But there are nevertheless some ways to avoid the first of all, even if gravitino dominates the universe, gravitino decay can reheat the universe. This is one possibility, but in that case, we need to be careful about the LSP abundance. Another one is that to make gravitino heavy so that kinematically decay cannot happen. Another one is that after gravitino is many copiously produced, it dilutes by entropy production. The fourth possibility is to break the produced gravitinos by R parity violation. I will skip this discussion section. This is parallel to the discussion section in my paper, but not so important. So let me summarize. We proposed an alternative realization of inflation model in supergravity with minimal degrees of freedom, such that inflaton, real single degree of freedom, and graviton and gravitino. For this purpose, to realize such a minimal situation, alternative minimal model, we used a recently proposed chiral superfield with constraint, which I called cubic nilpotent superfield. And importantly, the inflatino is not removed by this constraint, and only the scalar superpartner of the inflaton is removed or decoupled. So in our model, gravitino is not slow, and because of this, there is no anomalous or catastrophic production related to the sound speed change. Similar to the conventional theory, there is standard gravitino problem, and in fact, in our case, this abundance is very large. But still, there are several ways to avoid the catastrophic conclusion. So the main point is that this one, the speed, sound speed is regular. Thank you for your attention and sorry for long talk.
But... Okay, thank you. So I think the seminar was longer than expected, but I think it's good to learn something. So yeah, if you have some questions, you can ask. And maybe we can discuss a little bit after that. So if you have any questions. So I have a question on the your cubic nilpotent nilpotent constraint. So supersymmetry is broken by inflaton supermultiplet and the epitome of the inflaton, and in the minimum of the potential, the supersymmetry remains broken, or Suji is restored in the minimum of the potential and introduce Suji breaking.
So in the examples in this, in these examples, I think I checked that the supersymmetry is still broken at the minimum of the potential.
Mm.
Otherwise, this constraint superfield description becomes no longer valid. Right, because precisely speaking, it's not obvious, but we have this. So this is the derived by this paper. Here, U, there is a U in many parts in the denominator. U is this one. So here, F is the F term of the inflaton phi. So if the energy, if the kinetic energy and potential energy vanishes, again, U vanishes. So it's problematic. The description breaks down. So if we use this theory throughout the whole cosmological history, then the supersymmetry is broken. So it should be broken at the minimum. But this can be a good starting point for the discussion that, so as you say, it is also possible to consider the scenario in which inflaton restores supersymmetry so that it is more easily compatible with the low energy supersymmetry breaking scenario. In that case, the description in terms of the constraint superfield is only limited variability for time window, only during inflation and maybe at a fast stage of reheating or something like that. And after that, the supersymmetry is broken by another field. So this can be also possible. In that case, the phenomenologically good thing or advantage is that because inflaton does not break supersymmetry at the minimum, gravitino problem can be mild, because its abundance is correlated with how much inflaton breaks supersymmetry. So yeah, so the question is related to this kind of another interesting scenario.
I think the motivation for the constraint, I mean, nilpotent constraint is that the minimality for the surge breaking and inflation. So surge breaking inflation, and then this x square equal to zero constraint it comes from the nonlinear supersymmetry, right? So nonlinear supersymmetry,
yes.
You want to describe the surge breaking in a minimal way and without introducing dynamical scalar field. And you have a fermion, which is observed by the gravitino, and you have a surge breaking. and then you want to construct the low energy effective Lagrangian in terms of this constrained spot field. So I think the phenomenologically well motivated, although you know, you are still in the effective theory below the mass of the additional scalar field. And I think it is fine that we have a Suji breaking from the constrained spot field. And then the question is whether in this minimal setup, Suji, sorry, in this minimal setup, the inflation can be realized. And then you are asking this question also for this minimal possibility. And so x square, so x square equal to zero, I forgot your conclusion for the simplest case where x square equal to zero.
Simplest case.
Yeah, it's in this simplest case, if x is the inflaton, then you have a Suji breaking from the inflaton, and you have inflatino, which is should be absorbed by the gravitino. So in that case, was it a problem, right? There was a problem? In the simplest case, yeah.
Do you mean this kind of,
mm-hmm.
this kind of case?
Mm-hmm. Yes, for inflation.
For inflation.
Yeah. Because of that, you are changing to another constraint, or this constraint is not consistent with inflation. I remember there's some discussion, but
first of all, if we literally use this, consider this kind of setup, then scalar field becomes decoupled. So this multiplet cannot be used for the inflaton.
All right, the complex field is completely decoupled.
Yeah. So in that sense, this cubic nilpotent constraint is useful to only decouple the real or imaginary part.
Mm. I see. Okay.
Dashed line means half of them coupled.
Mm. I see.
Or that is the another answer. How to say is that that is the reason why people introduced one more superfield conventionally to introduce inflaton.
I see. What about x minus x dega scale? Instead of x scale, x minus x bar scale.
I haven't tried that.
You have a similar, you have a constraint only on the imaginary part.
So this is cubic and why not quadratic?
Quadratic x minus.
I don't know.
There is no.
Perhaps we obtain new constraint field, or I don't know.
I think that this constraint looks. Minimal, but it's kind of D-term, right? This is kind of D-term constraint. So it's sensitive. Is it UV sensitive?
What do you mean by UV sensitive? This constraint.
So D-term, I mean the F-term is not renormalized, but the D-term, you have UV dependence. D term is renormalized, so non-renormalized also.
Right. So for example, we can imagine, you can imagine a possibility completion for decoupling half of the complex field. For example, we can use a similar trick like this. For example, but in this case, it's. Sorry, I'm not sure.
Because it seems that you are actually, if I think about UV completion of your constraint, you have to introduce some Lagrange multiplier in the D term, in the case of S minus S bar, I mean, certain power of S minus S bar. You need to introduce it in the D term. In the case of X square, I mean, the minimal, I mean, nilpotent case, you can introduce it in the F term, right? So by additional field, Lagrange multiplier, superfield, then if it is dynamical, I mean, that Lagrange multiplier becomes dynamical, you have a kind of UV theory. Only after integrate out heavy field, you have a constraint. So I think that you can have a kind of more controllable UV completion. So in the case of deep term constraint, you have a UV sensitivity. So you have a cutoff, 1/λ separation. So in principle, you can keep adding even more powers in the D term. So because of that, I'm talking about because of I don't know if people discussed about UV completion, and in each case of nilpotent superfields, then it might be more clear. So
actually, the original paper about this example too, it introduces quotic term of phi minus phi bar in addition to this. So in this slide, we assume that cubic nilpotency condition, so it is not written. But in the original paper, we do not introduce the constraint, and instead there is a quotic term, phi minus phi bar quotic. And I think it's a similar role to the introduction slide, x quotic over lambda squared.
Mm.
And maybe this is also similar to what you said. It's a higher order term to
the higher order term interaction to additional superfield. It's like you have a constraint multiplied by some additional superfield, and equation motion for that gives rise to a constraint equation.
Yeah, I think it's possible to build some models using superpotential interaction.
Superpotential is easy. Yeah. So even for x square equal to zero, it is easy to find a renormalizable superpotential.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, in the sense that there is no higher order. There is no higher order terms like cubic term in the superpotential.
But the integrating out heavy degrees of freedom introduces the correction to the Keller potential.
Yeah, I think in this more general cases, like including phi bar in your constraint at the same time, then it is the constraint appearing in the D term, not in the F term. So it is more UV sensitive in the sense.
All right.
So I see.
So you say that this combination is not chiral. So
yeah, it's not chiral. So it should appear in the deep term.
Right. I see.
So I think, yeah. So then I think that I understand your motivation to consider the nilpotent superfield. I think, yeah. But I still need to understand the origin of the sound speed, the general formula for the sound speed. And then what is the issue? I don't know, maybe there should be no issue if you include the inflatino in your spectrum. It seems to, I mean, it seems that, right?
Yeah, I expect so. If we start from healthy UV theory.
Yeah, because in the first example, you decouple inflatino and you are trouble with a crossing, I mean, the changing sign problem of the sound speed. But in the second case, when you have inflatino included, there's no problem.
Yes.
So it seems that inflatino is necessary. It is necessary to include inflatino. You cannot decouple it. So
What about the fermions which interact with graviton or Goldsteino? It's better to keep in the low energy spectrum.
So, but as you said, for gravitino problem, standard gravitino problem, it is important to suppress the branching ratio of the inflaton decaying into gravitino pair. So yeah, so it's hard to reconcile in a minimal setup. So because I talked to Alvarez Gomez when I was a son, he wrote a paper about nilpotent superfield for inflation. With, I think,
Goldsteino inflation, minimal inflation scenario.
Yeah, Goldsteino inflation at that time, in the minimal scenario. He was asking the same question, whether it is possible to break supersymmetry only one time.
Only one
because,
time?
because Suji is broken for inflation, but somehow he was not satisfied. Oh. Suji is restored in the minimum, and then you break Suji one more time. So maybe another mechanism. So he was not satisfied with that. And so, yeah, so he wanted to see if it is possible to. But I thought that his model was successful, but I don't know, it is satisfactory, I don't know, from the point of view of naturalness or some symmetry. But I want to see, I want to revisit this problem from your point of view of gravitino problem. Very nice too.
Yeah, in their scenario, yeah, there should be also the standard gravitino problem.
Yeah, standard gravitino problem is unavoidable. Okay. So I think it would be nice to talk to you in person and then write on something on the blackboard, whiteboard, and so have some more extensive discussion. But I think we are now more than 2 hours, so I think it's good time to. It's not good, but this is right. We need to finish in this seminar. Okay. Do you have any urgent question or comment? Then maybe we can finish this seminar. Okay. Thank you, Takahiro, for your extensive seminar and nice discussion.
Thank you so much for your attention.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Thank you, everyone. Okay. Thank you.